home can hear everybody because we're going to read it so loud. Are you ready? All right, Psalm 122. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firmly together, to which the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, as was decreed for Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. There, thrones for judgment were set, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they be secure who love you. Peace be within your walls and security within your towers. For my brothers and companions' sake, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good. Amen. Let's sing together. Peace be within your walls and security within your towers.
Is broken.
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made?
Every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom. God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is.
Redemption, God, with
presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah
louder than the unbelief.
I raise a hallelujah.
My weapon is a melody. To fight for me, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is defeated, the King is alive.
have a seat.
I'm Don Gilchrist, one of the elders here at Crossway. I just want to say your elder board loves you and appreciates your patience as we kind of do all these extra things so we can be together in person. I'm going to be reading from John 1 this morning. Before I do that, I do have one extra family matter kind of announcement, and that is you'll have noticed by now that Pastor Kyle Brennan is not in the sanctuary with us yet. He will be coming in very soon. But the elder board has asked him to be extra careful because of his specific health concerns that he has. They are extreme, and we need to take care of him. He will be on the stage. We ask people not to approach the stage, not to approach Kyle. If you see him in the hallway, run away. And unfortunately, this means that Sarah and the kids will not be able to be with us for a while either. That's weird. We don't like it, but we just want you to know why that is the case. And we're going to love them and take care of them. So on with the reading of Scripture, John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Verse 9, the true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Who were born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. How wonderful it is that God has taken the initiative throughout history to reveal himself to us, and his ultimate revelation is in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He has made it possible for us to know and enjoy him, and he has even shown us his glory. And these are words that should encourage us to live the gospel out day by day. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we are so thankful that salvation has appeared, that grace has come, and we know it has come in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we gather in his name, we direct our thoughts to you and seek your glory and ask that the name of the Lord Jesus would be magnified. Thank you for inviting us in and that we get to enjoy you as we sit in this room, Lord, we say we love you, and we love the way you take care of us and provide for us. Although we would often normally be passing an offering plate this morning, we won't be doing that, Lord. We still want to offer ourselves to you, to offer our praise, our whole lives. And we do it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Hey, everybody. Where have you been? Some of you guys ain't been to church in a while. Man, I'm going to try not to cry just because I don't have to preach to a cell phone. I had no idea how emotional I would be this morning. I was locked in my bunker listening to you guys sing, and I had to sneak out into the hallway to hear it, like, without just the speaker. I may have cried. I don't know. No one saw it, so just be quiet about it. Why you got to ask? Pretty crazy. We're so glad you guys are here this morning. That is an understatement. Man, that is such an understatement. I want to also say, I know we've done this before. I could hear most of what was going on. I know we've already said hi and welcome to the people that are listening online, but let me do that anyway. I'm looking up to the balcony as if they can see me, but I'm going to do that anyway. So if you're listening from home, we love you guys. We miss you so much. We're glad that you made the choice to stay home, if that's what's right for you. Absolutely. Yeah, you clap for that. Absolutely. We want you guys to know that you are every bit as much a part of what we're doing and a part of this church, even though you're watching from home, you're listening from home. We'll have video up soon. So I just want to say that. I know that Don mentioned this a minute ago, but I want to speak to it a little bit personally, just because I've got to do it. If you're at home, you didn't notice that I walked out of the side door of the stage. If you're here, obviously you saw that. So if you're at home also, we asked you to stay home if you're vulnerable. Here's the thing. You know, I don't like this, but it's still true. I shouldn't be here. I say that in the fact that I'm one of those vulnerable people. I have severe asthma, so the elder board and my doctor who's on the elder board have said, hey man, you got to play it cool. You got to keep away from just general population. But I don't want to be on a video in here. Like, I don't want you guys to all gather and watch me on video. I'm not built for TV, clearly. And we want to be able to be together. So we're just taking some pretty easy precautions, right? I'm hiding in a bunker back there, where nobody can get to me. I hate that I can't be in the foyer, hanging out with you guys, shaking hands, bumping fists, which you guys can't do that right now either. But I hate that I can't be doing that. It's not fun, but that's where we're at the moment. That's just where we are. So I just want to tell you guys that, and you also heard that Sarah and the kids won't be here, really for the same reason, for a little while. We don't know how long, hopefully not long, for the same reason, just that I can't keep my kids from hugging you. There's no way. This is not going to happen, and it's not fair for me to do that anyway, and so to keep them from being at risk then would put me at risk. We're just doing it that way, so please be patient, forgive me for that. We'll get through it. We'll get through it, and it's a good thing. We're gonna jump in, man. We got a lot to do. One thing you're gonna notice also that we've changed around the sermon. The whole service is gonna be a little bit shorter. Don't clap. It's gonna be a little bit shorter. It's gonna be a little bit shorter because we want to keep everybody from having to go to the bathroom six times in the middle of the service. So we're gonna try to go fast and get through. But we're gonna make sure we've got everything that we need, and we're not gonna cut the Lord short. We aren't. So let's pray together right now. We're gonna jump into what I believe the Lord has for us this morning. I'm so excited. Pray with me if you would. Father in heaven, you are so good to us. So good to us. We're thankful for the opportunity this morning to gather together, and that probably means a little more to us today than it ever has. Father, we can see each other's face, that we can be with each other in the same room, the body of Christ together as we were designed to be. Lord, we need each other because you made us that way, and we're thankful that we can be here. Lord, we're thankful for your word. We ask this morning as we look at your word that you would give us eyes to see, faith to believe that it is true, Lord, and that your word would have its effect on us, that it would not land on hard soil, but Lord, that our hearts would be fertile ground, that your word would take root, that you would grow it in us, and that we would be drawn to you, that you would change us, Father, through your word and the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep me far out of the way as you do the things in us that you want to do. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so this morning we are going to be continuing in our series Awake My Soul out of the Book of Psalms. I hope you guys have been enjoying it. I have. I really liked it more than I thought I would, and I thought I'd like it a lot. So we're going to jump right in. Our anchor passage for the series is Psalm 57, 8 through 10, which says, "Awake my soul, awake, O harp and lyre. I will awake the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. This is our goal for this series, that as we walk through some of the Psalms together, God would awaken something within us that may have been asleep for a very long time. And through His Word, the Holy Spirit would reveal to us what is true about Him. And then how that applies to our lives. Like our daily lives, not just this lofty idea of who God is, but meet us right where we're at. That these truths that we will discover will have great, great effect on each of us. We've looked at a number of psalms so far. Last week we began Psalm 139, one of the more theologically rich psalms in the entire book of Psalms. And if you joined us last week, you may remember that we said Psalm 139 is broken down into four sections, four pretty obvious sections. And we're gonna spend a few weeks going through this psalm. We're gonna sit on it for a while. I can't sprint through it. It's just too good. The first section, verses 1 through 7, which we looked at last week, David focuses on God's omniscient nature. He focuses on that. This is that God knows everything, right? And he applies it to his own life, specifically in his relationship with the Lord. In this second section, verses 7 through 12, which we're going to be looking at today, David focuses his worship on the fact that God is omnipresent. He is omnipresent, that is, God is everywhere at once. And David applies this to his relationship with God by taking comfort and joy in knowing that God is with him. God is with him. And we'll see as we go along today that we can take that same joy as well. Third, verses 13 through 18, we'll see that God is all-powerful, that he is the grand designer, having created us with intentionality and purpose. And finally, verse 19 through 24, we'll see David's response to these truths. Abandoning everything that is against the Lord and aligning himself with God in submission. That's where we're going with all this. So let's take a look at today's section of Psalm 139, and we'll read 1 through 6 leading up to it, and then we get to 7 through 12, we'll break it down. Let me just pause real quick and say for a second, it's really wigging me out that you guys are sitting in the wrong seats. You are supposed to be here. You are supposed to be here. You're supposed to be right there. It's wigging me out, man. It's wigging me out. All right, now I can move on. Starting in verse one. Nothing happened. Those at home, pay no attention. Verse 1. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path, my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, and I cannot attain it. And beginning in verse 7, today's passage, where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. David asks, where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? He's not working out an escape plan, right? He's not figuring out, okay, what do I got to do? Do I go through here and sneak through? Like, where can I get to where God isn't? That's not what he's doing. He's not trying to figure out a way to get away from the Lord. It's not why he's posing this question. He's not lamenting over the fact that he can't hide from God. No, he is praising God for this. He is praising God for it. He is taking great comfort in this truth that he cannot go anywhere to escape God's presence. He takes joy in that. He loves the fact that no matter where he goes, he is never alone and that God is always with him. In fact, the way we respond to this reality tells us a lot about where our hearts are, right? if we cringe at this, if we think, yeah, man, God is everywhere, we cringe at that, we step back and think, well, that's not really good. I don't want there to be nowhere I can hide from God. I need at least one dark corner somewhere that I can go where he won't be, right? I need some place, even if in my own heart, that I can hide these things that I don't want him to know are there. If that's our mentality, if that's what we think, we've probably all been there at some point in our life. If that's what we think, if that's where our mind goes, then not only do we not understand who God is, but we're missing out on the relationship he wants us to have with him. Completely. Completely. David takes joy in the fact that God is ever present. And remember David's life, right? We know David. Remember his life. What was it like? First of all, he was the king of Israel. He's the king of Israel. That's a lonely place to be, man. That's a lonely. The higher up the ladder of responsibility and leadership you are placed, the lonelier it gets. And David was about as high up as on that ladder as a person can get. He knew what it meant to be lonely. Second, for David, running for his life and hiding in dark caves while people are trying to kill him was kind of his hobby. Right? He was no stranger to that. It wasn't his favorite hobby, but it was a hobby. He knew what it was like to be on the run, to be hated by his enemies, to be chased down. That's lonely, man. What comfort there was to be found in this truth for David, that no matter where he was, no matter where he was never alone. This is the comfort that he took. Man, I remember one of the most surprising things to me when I first gave my life to the Lord. I was in high school. One of the most surprising things to me was how this loneliness that I felt, that I carried with me, that I thought was deserved and permanent, began to fade away. That was shocking to me. Shocking to me. I didn't expect that one. Most of us can probably relate to that somewhere deep down as well. We know what it's like to be lonely in a crowd. Sounds like an impossibility, but it is not. It is not. And it still sneaks up on us. It still sneaks up on me. My goodness. 2 months for an extrovert to be locked in a house, that was not cool. Not cool. It sneaks up on all of us. But God is always faithful. Certainly to me, to give me a gentle reminder that he is with me. Proverbs 18:24, even, right? There's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. No matter what. No matter what. Even if we actually are physically alone, we are never alone. So David finds comfort, not fear, in knowing that God is everywhere. Everywhere. As he says, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? Then he says, if I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the outermost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me and your right hand shall hold me. These are two examples of two extremes. Heaven, the highest of heights, right? An almost unimaginable distance. Sheol, also translated depths or grave, even hell in some places. This is the lowest of lows, right? Two extremes that he's comparing. And the wings of the morning, that is where the sun rises and the morning begins in the east. And the uttermost parts of the sea, the complete opposite direction. The farthest west where the sun will set. In all of that, God is there. This is a powerful poetic image. David's saying, God, you are as high as the heavens. You are as low as the depths. Where the sun rises up beyond our vision, you are there. On the other side of the horizon, completely in the seas unknown, where the sun sets, you are there. And everywhere in between. Everywhere in between. Can I find any place, God, where you are not? He says, no. No. Even there, verse 10, even there, your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. You shall lead me. He's not just there with us, right? He doesn't just exist there, but even there in the uttermost places, in the lowest depths, he will lead us. He will lead us. God doesn't just exist in these far out places, in the dark corners where we think we're hidden or we think he doesn't want to go. But when we find ourselves there, in those dark places, he is still God. He is still God, and he still leads us, even in the depths. Here's what I mean. No matter how big of a mess we may find ourselves in, no matter how much trouble we have made for ourselves, if we listen and we surrender, he will lead us through it. He will lead us through it. We need to hear that. Then David says, your right hand shall hold me. Your right hand shall hold. That's a good one. We're going to come back to that one at the end. Put a little mark there. We're going to come back to that one. Put a placeholder. Your right hand shall hold me. Verse 11, if I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me. Don't miss this right here. There are two types of darkness. Probably more than two, but for this example, there are two types of darkness. There is physical darkness, and there is spiritual darkness. Physical darkness and spiritual darkness. And there are quite a few parallels between the two. Physical darkness brings out much of the same things that spiritual darkness brings out. When it's dark, you can't see. That's a shocking revelation. Did you guys know that? When it's dark, you can't see? You read the Bible, you learn that. It's in there, yeah? When it's dark. When it's dark, you can't see. When it's physically dark, you can't see. And when it's spiritually dark, you can't see. When it's dark, you can't get any bearings on your surroundings. Both physically and spiritually, you can't get your bearings. And when it's dark, and when you can't find your bearings, fear and loneliness will find you. Fear and loneliness will find you, physically and spiritually. You may say, well, Kyle, I'm a grown man. I'm not afraid of the dark. Well, that all depends on where you are now, doesn't it? It makes a big difference. We're not afraid in our own home because we know our bearings. We know where we're at. But if I stick you down in the middle of the jungle somewhere and you hear a roaring lion over here, you're going to be afraid. You're going to be afraid. I will. It doesn't matter who you are. Fear and loneliness will find you in the darkness. And when a spiritual darkness descends on us, we feel it in a way that is barely describable. It just engulfs us. It's disorienting. It brings confusion. Simple things create chaos in the darkness. We lose sight of what matters because we begin to panic. And it's so often hard to see where God is and what he's doing when we find ourselves in spiritual darkness. It's a lonely place to be. And some of us are there right now. Some of us are there. Some of us have been there for a while. We all go through some form of spiritual darkness one time or another. And in this darkness, there is desperation. There is desperation. Verse 11 continues, if I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night. Which is pointing to this feeling of spiritual loneliness, abandonment, forsakenness, and the feeling that the Lord is no longer near us. David says to this, no. Even the darkness, whether physical or spiritual, is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, he says. For darkness is as light with you. He sees it all. There's never confusion with the Lord. When it's dark and we find it increasingly difficult to see, and I don't mean physically, I hope you guys can hear me on this. When it feels as though surely the darkness shall cover us, that we have been left alone in it, we can't see where God is and we can't see what he's doing, we know that to the Lord, the night is bright as day, for the darkness is light with him. And no matter where we are when that darkness creeps in, No matter how high or how low, how far or how wide, we will never escape his presence. We can't. Just ask Jonah, right? Good luck outrunning God and his presence. This is what we see in verse 7 through 12. David is finding comfort in the fact that God is near. That wherever he goes, no matter what heights or depths, if he takes the wings of the morning or dwells in the uttermost parts of the sea, the Lord is always near to him. We said we'd come back to verse 10. This is it right here. Even there, as far as you can imagine, right, both sides and everything between, even there, your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. What's the significance of God's right hand? Why bother making that distinction here? Because he does it on purpose. Your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me. What's the point of that distinction? God's right hand points to his righteousness. His right hand illustrates his power, and his right hand is synonymous with his authority. Isaiah 41:10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, and I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." It illustrates his power. Psalm 118:16, "The right hand of the Lord exalts. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly." And it is synonymous with his authority. Psalm 110:1, "The Lord said to my Lord." I know that's confusing. Translated Hebrew, it says Yahweh says to Adonai is what it is. Yahweh says to Adonai, or Yahweh says to my master, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." And Hebrews 10, 12 through 13 tells us exactly who he's talking about when he says, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Hebrews 10, 12 through 13, "When Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet." I think that's so cool. I hope we can follow that right through the Old Testament and right into the New Testament. It's about Jesus. That is so cool. So what's the point of all that? God's near us all the time. I get it. Not a difficult concept, Kyle. We could have had this sermon done in 3 minutes, right? Well, you hear me say this all the time. Every story has a hero, and Jesus is the hero of every story in Scripture. What on earth does Psalm 139 have to do with Jesus? And why does the gospel have to be true in order for Psalm 139 to be true? Well, guys, Psalm 139 isn't just giving us a picture of a God who is near us. Psalm 139 is giving us a picture of a God who is with us. A God who is with us, and there is a big difference. Huge difference. It's a difference between knowing God and knowing about God. It's a difference about learning information and having a relationship. It's a difference between heaven and hell. That's the difference. Listen, God is near to everyone, but he's only with those who have placed their faith in Emmanuel, which means God with us. God made flesh to dwell among us. How is it that an infinite God cannot just be near us, but that he can be with us? He comes to us in the form of man. That's how. That's how. We began this morning with John 1, and we're going to end there as well. This beautiful picture we get in Psalm 139 of the relationship we can have with the all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-present God of the universe is only available to us because the gospel is true. It is only available to us because the gospel is true. It is only available because Christ has offered for all time a single sacrifice for our sins, and having completed his work, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. John 1:1-5. Again, we started there, we're going to end there. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Psalm 139 matters because the gospel is true. The relationship that it describes is only unlocked because the gospel is true. Never doubt that the gospel has to be woven through all of it. If Jesus never died, this doesn't matter. If he never rose again, this doesn't matter. But he did. So it matters. And it's true. So as we look at that, and as we continue through Psalm 139 in the weeks to come, remember that it's only true because the gospel is true. It only matters because the gospel is true. Let's pray, and we're going to move into a time of communion. Father in heaven, we're thankful again for your word. We're thankful that we see Jesus through all of it. We're thankful that the gospel is true, and that because of that, this relationship, Lord, that you paint such a beautiful picture of in the pages of Psalms, even, that it is available to us by your grace through the blood of Christ. Father, continue to open our eyes to that truth. And be with us now as we move into a time of communion. In Christ's name, amen. All right, in the back of your chair, you are going to find one of the back of the chair in front of you. You're going to find one of these little deals, little cup, and in it there's a wafer on the top. It's delicious. And then, of course, the juice. You can go ahead and open it now. There are a number of different ways that we do communion, logistically at least. Sometimes we come forward. Sometimes we pass a tray. Sometimes we take it on our own. These are all good ways to do it. This morning we're gonna do it together. We're gonna do it all together, which is a little different than normal. And if you're not comfortable with that, or if you need to pray for a while longer before we do it. That's totally fine, absolutely fine. Take as much time as you need. But we're gonna kind of work it through, and then we're gonna take it together. So I'm going to pray over that, and then we're going to read through this. And if you're at home, I know this sounds weird. If you're at home, you can take communion at home. Run and grab some grape juice. Run and grab some bread that's going to taste better than this stuff we've got right here. But it's symbolic. Symbolic. It's all good. And you can do that. 1 Corinthians 11. 23 through 25, Paul says this. You know how long I've been wanting to take communion with you guys? A long time. That's what he said. It's kind of the Kyle version, but no, it's not what he said. It says this. It says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's pray together. Father in heaven, again, we thank you. And we thank you right now for Christ's body that was broken for us, the church, that the wrath we deserved was poured out on him, diverted from us, satisfied on the cross. Body broken, Lord. We are thankful for your mercy to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Let's take together the bread. In the same way, also he took the cup. after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Father, we're thankful for the blood shed on the cross, for the forgiveness of our sins, to redeem us, to purchase us back, your bride, your church, your own people, paying for the sins we could not pay for by your grace. Let's take together the cup. Let's pray once more before we continue in worship. Father in heaven, it's a bit overwhelming this morning with all that's going on. Layers of emotion and complexity. We miss each other. Our country is at odds. The world tears itself apart. Father, we are thankful for the peace you offer us. The peace that you offer us through the blood of Christ. Lord, we are your people. We are thankful. I pray, Lord, the things we looked at this morning in your word will take root in our heart. You will transform us. You will continue to mold us in the image of your Son, that you may be glorified in us. We walk out our faith in relationship with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand again and sing together.
Sons to glory.
whose wounds have paid my ransom. Christ is mine forevermore.
I'm going to send us out with a blessing this morning. I'm going to read from Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. And after I read this, then I'm going to ask that you guys all will sit down and wait for the ushers to dismiss you. They're going to start with the balcony, and then they'll start from over here and then move across. So I'm going to read this blessing over us, and then we'll all take our seats. It says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace."